Marc Geiger, head of music at WME, and John MacFarlane from Sonos.
Pete, you're supposed to give a disclaimer that we work together, so that's how this all happened.
You mean you yell at me? And
exactly. And this is the CEO of Sonos, not just some guy from Sonos.
Which means I do the least in Sonos.
Yeah.
You used to do a lot, actually. So, little funny story, because Arthur Baker was here, and I was working with Rick Rubin for, I don't know, 6-7 years, good friend of mine, and when I was at American with him, the internet was just coming around, and the browser had just been launched. This was Mosaic in 94. And as we worked together, I sort of dragged him kicking and screaming, because he's an older school analog guy, into the digital age. And one of the things that was a big common love of us, for us, was the first Sonos that came out. Because it actually managed, at that time, digital music clearly was not where it is today. And it had a crazy controller. It was like a brick, had a dial on it.
We call it our Russian iPod.
There you go. And Rick and I both were so passionate about Sonos, we kind of groveled our way into John's life. And we've been there both ever since. I don't remember what year it was, but it's been a... it's been a fascinating ride, because to me, who's sort of a wannabe digital poster boy, there's the theory of digital music and how we're all consuming music, and then there's the practice. And the practice has to do with really boring things like user interface, usability, and things like that. Sorry, I thought I was going to feed back. That's why I was holding it. All right. And usability, user interface, and really boring technical things that geeks enjoy. And Sonos was the first one that could aggregate to me all of my music discovery and choices, whether it was a Pandora station, whether it was the earliest days of Rhapsody or Napster, when it became legal, and my hard drive all in one, because otherwise I was shifting things around and jumping around. There was no management system. And so I just want to open up by saying two things. One, it was a very formative time in digital music, and Sonos's growth is fantastic. This is not an ad for Sonos. I'm just that much of a fan. And two, hats off. I wore the purple shirt, but not because I knew he died, but it was a random synchronicitous choice. Anyway, John?
Thank you. You worked with Prince, right?
For 8 years.
Yeah.
How are we going to get to 1 billion paying subscribers? I put my you-know-what on the line. I think they want to hear it. I want to hear it from you. Give me the ramp. How's this going to work?
All right. I would say it all started with, you mentioned Rhapsody. They had the first vision of the on-demand service. They were just too early. Of course, when Napster washed through the whole world, the one country that had a safe harbor was Sweden. So you have Spotify starting in Sweden and really working hard on converting the young people who were starting free and to a paid service. So you have Spotify as the really right timing and capital structure and everything and focus on it. And they've, of course, Zoom to number one. I think they announced 30 million paying subscribers. And of course, the US has Pandora, but I would liken that more to modern radio. And Apple getting in last year was the first to then really work on awareness. Spotify and Pandora got awareness through word of mouth. We all heard about it from a friend or someone else. And that's a slow burn. And not that 30 million's not a significant number, but it's a long way from 1 billion. So Apple getting in, and now Apple is starting on the awareness campaign, all the traditional marketing you have to do for awareness. And if you live in Sweden, something like 20% of the population is a paid music subscriber. So it's mainstream there. If you look at any user coming into Sonos with a new system, 100% have paid music streaming. So in Sweden, it's already happened. In China, they skipped the whole download. Baidu got started like Napster, but the Chinese government came in as only it can and said no more And that whole market is shifting to streaming. So you have those two outliers that go straight to streaming. And then the whole rest of us, with the US playing the last position of coming up. And of course, in the traditional music market, as you know, it used to be US number one. You'd add up a couple of markets in Europe and you'd add up Japan, and then everybody else would be rest of world. So in this internet connected world, you look at Facebook's numbers and it's the whole world of people who love music. And you see Spotify and Apple Music in every country, almost every country across the planet. Apple Music's even in China. So I think as they get their mojo going, you'll see them, you'll see Google, you know, and the challenge with Google is you've got Google Play Music on one hand and you've got YouTube on the other, and how do those interrelate and what does it mean for a paid streaming service? And I think Apple kind of setting the bar with only a paid music streaming service. It's $10 or $15 if you do a family. There's no halfway step. There's no freemium. It's a, you know, 3-month trial, get going. I think their last announced number, 11 or 12 million, and they're really starting to go. And of course, the only barrier to an Apple Music user is they've got, I don't know the numbers, 120 million people's credit cards in is go. So they just need to get to critical mass, and they've got a base that's easily activated. That's upping the ante for Spotify. They're starting to do awareness, and that's what you need to do to get the numbers going. And this whole community, I think, has been tremendously fractured in views. You know, the managers, the labels, I mean, if you talk to Lucian Grange, I used to talk to all the labels and I'd ask them, who are your customers? And even 5 years ago, most of them would answer, you know, Tower Records, or maybe a little more than five, but they all answer the listener and paid music streaming, and we're all speculating on what's the number to 200 million, what's the number to a billion. So when's a billion? 2021, 2022?
Five years-ish.
Yeah.
So in summary, 5 years to get to a billion paid streams, streaming paying customers. China and Apple take the lead, right? Everybody else comes in, and that's the summary.
Yeah, the weird part in China
is, I would agree, by the way.
Yeah. The weird part in China is right now, like a QQ Music pays, but they don't charge. So,
I think
you know,
pay a buck. Because I was in Australia and I've had a meeting with Universal's MD, and it was interesting. He's responsible for Asia Pacific. And on his annual revenue,
yeah,
they had zero from China. It was all piracy.
Yeah.
This year.
Oh, they had ringtones, but yeah.
This year was the first year they got paid, and he said we had $485 million Australian, which isn't bad for a first year when you're going from zero to Asia. And mm-hmm. I saw some report, I think Billboard wrote, that must add a typo. They said $73 trillion, some stupid amount of money, but it clearly has skin.
And some other currency you didn't know.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So it was in yuan or whatever. But that's pretty impressive. So you think a billion 5 years. So yeah, we're going to start to see a hockey stick of growth.
Yeah. Now the trick is, what are each of those billion users paying? You know, Apple Music everywhere but China is about 10 US, 10 euros. In China, it's 10 RMB, which is divide by six, you know, a smaller number. If you looked into Deezer's IPO filing, which really told a lot, you could see, I think they'd announced around 10 million paying users. There were about 1.5 that were paying full fare. And so there were a fair number like that had gone with the Orange service that they only paid if they used it, and Orange would pay, and it was a lesser amount of money. So the trick inside of there also is, what is the payment? And there's so much confusion right now. You see the IFPI or the RIAA also blending in the free music price, which is substantially lower because they're you know, doing a revenue share of ads in there. So what's the per you know, month cost or per track, and that brings it down substantially. So part of the challenge in this industry is there's depending on who you ask, you're going to get.
Let me guess. There's the hype and there's the reality.
Yeah.
Got it. In numbers.
And you know what the artist cares about, which is where you got to start. Then the manager, then the label is what is the number of full paying? So when, you know, and that number at 10 US, you know, if you get to 200 million subs, you're $120 a year. You know, it actually makes a larger revenue pie than the music industry ever had, even at the peak of the CD. So yeah.
Listen, trust me, I'm the moron that went on record and said it's a $200 billion industry, which I still believe, by the way. Let me ask you another question. So it feels to me that we're going into the age of data and analytics. We've had rudimentary data and analytics, and I remember in the age of record stores and other things, and by the way, even in the age of files with all the privacy, you couldn't get any of the data, let alone the estimated bullshit that we would all get from retail and what have you. Today, we're in a log file. Everybody knows everything once they can open the gates, and everybody pitches me, Shazam, Pandora, everybody. I got better data, Spotify, I got thumbs up. No, I've seen who can listen 10 times. You're actually in one of the best data positions to me, because you're seeing not only exactly the micro of what people are listening to, you get to see a cross pan music service.
Yeah.
So you told me a story, I don't know how many years ago, probably 3-4 years ago, that really bummed me out. You said most, you were just reporting. You told me most people who use Sonos were listening to internet radio and then Pandora. Where are we now?
Yeah, so if you looked at the U.S., because Pandora is only available in the U.S. and Australia, I think one half of the listening time on Sonos, call it north of a million homes, is Pandora. One half of the listening time. A quarter is internet radio, and then the last quarter is the on-demand services and the... you know, your local library.
Is that today?
That's today, okay. Listening time.
Where was it when you told me that story?
It was a little less than that. So an instructive or a interesting contrast to that would be Sweden, where there's no Pandora. You've got Spotify at full penetration, and you've got, of course, internet radio. And it's about 50-50. It can shift to 60-40 either way, depending on the season. As you get near the holidays, it shifts harder to Spotify than the... but the interesting thing will be is when the labels start allowing the global radio services like a Pandora, if they do, because there isn't really any of those. Beats One would be the closest to that. It's free and it's a live radio, but Apple took the... Apple Radio services off the free tier. So if you've got Beats Radio, if you want free, or you pay the Apple Music. Now, Spotify and all the services, Googlebot, Songza, they're all integrating the lean back and lean forward listening. So it's a little harder to pull apart. But even in the US, when you look at a Sonos household with Spotify or a Sonos household with Apple Music, you'll see the predominant listening still is Pandora. You can see them eating into Pandora's a little bit, but it's still strongly there. And I know you're not a Pandora fan, but...
It's not that I'm not a Pandora fan. I mean, we're talking in front of active music users. Yeah. I would bet most of the people here are sound.
Yeah, this group will hate
Spotify.
Pandora generally, yeah.
So hopefully when I say I was bummed out, people here know why. Because there's a constant reminder that a lot of the world doesn't give as much of a fuck about music as I do, and a lot of the people in this room, or you do, or any of the people who are interested in new music, or what's the hot thing, or putting together a playlist. You know, if you think about the dance music community, mixes, playlists, it's core. And so when you hear Pandora, you get deflated. Well, not that it's bad. It's a great product for what it is. It's just lean back like these chairs. So it doesn't talk about really the future of people driving music consumption that way. It more mirrors sort of what we knew. A smaller percentage of people bought records and most listened to free radio in the old days. And the hope was by improving, and we'll see over time, by improving the music experience. You don't have to go to a record store. You can take it wherever you want. Obviously, all the benefits we have from digital music, plus all the choice, you know, and the on-demand choice, all the connectivity from blogs or reviews into, you know, direct linking into music services, that there's a feeling that people are listening to more music today than ever. Maybe I'm wrong, that it would switch them to more active music consumers.
Well, look, even if that pie chart stayed the same, what we do watch is people, if you make it easier to have music in your life, they listen to more. So, you know, it's that Bob Marley, It Heals the Soul, or, and I you see it. You beat me up over it a few years back when we had Spotify support, but we didn't have Spotify radio. And so I went back and looked at that before this, and, people that were Spotify users on Sonos listened to 23% more music once the radio came. So even if the pie stays the same, we're all good. You just make it easier to turn. Who doesn't want to turn on music when they're unpacking their groceries or, you know, making dinner or whatever it is? And if you make it easier, they do. Now that's going to be lean back listening, because you've got stuff in your hands when you walk in the door, and you're not going to sit there and choose a playlist. But that chunk is also lean forward. You know, that quarter chunk is lean forward, and I think it'll change too. It's hard to discover. You know, the internet, you know this better than I do. The internet went through the same thing. Once you can look for all the world's information, what the hell do you look for? Once you can play anything ever made anywhere, how do you help find it? And I think it's way early in the days of recommendation.
Well, listen, I work with Pete Tong, so I believe in curators, right? I believe in curation. I believe in curators. I guess I tend to want the needle to be even more in the arm of music consumers, right? Because what I saw, and when we talked about it, was that digital music consumption, usually I thought active, is driving stardom, it's driving ticket sales, concert attendances, globalizations, you know, globalization where music and record stores weren't freely available, right, to kids who were all over the world who didn't have the kind of choice. So to me, I think I'm probably a bit utopian about it all, and you tend to bring me back down to earth with people's habits. Speaking of coming back down to earth.
I have one for you on this, right, because as the tech industry gets ahead of the creative part of the music industry, it treats the music industry as a commodity. And, you know, if you're an artist, you're managing an artist, and they want to, you know, it's a highly creative process, and you want to present it to the world in the way you want it presented. And they don't quite cater to that yet. Do you think that will change? Because it's bridging two worlds, right?
Yeah, I don't actually agree with that. Okay. I think there's more ways to present yourself than there ever were. So if you think about the tools, again, I hate saying in the old days, but of a record cover, back, insert, the video or two you made, plus your press release and your bio, and whatever interviews you did. That was your toolkit.
Yep.
Today you have a channel on Snapchat, a channel on YouTube, a channel on Facebook, a channel on Instagram, a channel on blah, blah, blah. You probably aren't using Apple's Connect, but it's there.
There.
And you have a number of other places, plus the official website, dot, 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 dot. So I think from a palette toolkit, now I actually believe most people don't know how to use that.
Okay.
And as an artist, you have to be a multi-channel programmer, not just a musician. But the ones that do it, and whether you're a Vine star, a Twitch star, a YouTube star, a Snapchat, if you're DJ Khaled, you've learned how to use a new visual medium, right? A platform. And I think we're actually going in that wave too. So my gut is
Kim Kardashian meets Kanye West, and gets it right.
You know, I said this at the IMS many years ago about DJs and their imaging and the whole package. Part of the package is, how do you come across besides your music? Because you only have so much music to put on Instagram and Facebook and all the platforms. It's not even the best use of those platforms per se, right? That might be better in the SoundCloud. So I think we're in a bigger wave. And I think there's a lot of visual representation and imaging work that still has to be done by all artists, not just by electronic artists. I just thought electronic artists, because the music they made and they stood behind decks or what have you needed even more imaging. But I think everybody has to learn. I think it's a much harder job for artists. In the old days when you had a photographer and a publicist and you really didn't have to do that much. Now you have to put yourself in it, and the consumers know when you're not authentic and you're not there, right? And it's being ghostwritten. But I want to bring up one thing that happened with you.
How many artists are going to have that kind of sophistication, though?
I think over time a lot.
All of them?
I think over time. I think when you grow up in those mediums, if you have
All right. A
10, 13-year-old child today and you see that they are literally on their phones 24/7, more than an 18-year-old, by a lot.
Yeah.
And they're creating in Musical.ly or any of the photo and video software tools that are coming out. And there was a bunch of, it used to be Flipagram, and then it's they're learning video production skills, right? You know, you're learning, you can mix a record by shaking your iPhone with the right app. There's a lot of tools that people are getting good at right now. And I think over time, they will apply that to their channels, right? And I think that most people, I think anybody under the age of 25 looks at Snapchat and goes, I don't know what it is. And they miss the kids. That would be like not making a video for MTV back in the heyday. So I think there's technical challenges, understanding channels, challenges, interface challenges, time challenges, creative challenges, and that's all got to get solved. So back to coming down to earth. So a couple things happened the last few weeks which were pretty outstanding. One was Elon Musk landed a rocket, right?
Mm-hmm.
Floating part.
Pretty impressive.
Probably means a lot for all of our future about space travel. Probably pretty hard before that happened. I drove this last weekend, not to Coachella, that's this weekend. And I told John, I drove back and forth to Ventura without driving.
And he closed his eyes for
And I closed my eyes for 5 minutes on the freeway.
Going, you are a trusting man.
Using the new self-driving autopilot feature, and it worked perfectly on the freeway. All right. I thought that was pretty big. So you fired a bunch of people recently. I don't know how many. Hang on. Because you had a realization about technology. What was that about?
We're going through the exact same transition the whole industry is from purchase to subscription. So the first 10 years of Sonos were find you, find Rick, find who had a Love Music, had a digital music collection, and free it around your home. And at some point after that, we would introduce you to a subscription music service. So we were introducing people to subscription music services far more than we'd be able to go into Rhapsody's or Spotify's base and introduce them to Sonos. So you could argue, and we pretty much operated this way, and you pointed this out to me on multiple occasions, that core focus was your digital music collection. It was a feature for streaming services, and you could tell that when you set up a Sonos. So we had to flop that. Because as Apple got going, as the whole industry started really leaning into paid music streaming services, we needed to A, figure out how to go into those bases, into Apple, into Spotify, and get them to see you can play this around your house, just like we had done with you with your digital music collection. And we have to think about how we deliver that music in a world when you can play anything ever made. That's hugely liberating in many ways, because when you've got half of your customers that are listening to their library and then half that are on a streaming service, you can't introduce many features like, you know, I want to share a playlist with you, but I might be on Apple Music and you might be on Spotify, or you might come over to my house and you might want to pull your phone out and have your whole subscription library and whatever you last played be able to play on my Sonos. And that becomes all possible when you're on a subscription service. It's impossible when your, you know, collection is still sitting back at your house. It was a timing issue of when do you pivot. You know, same thing in some ways the cars are going through. When is it fully autonomous? And you know, same thing for Universal Music, same thing for this whole industry as it moves from a purchase library model to a subscription model, and it was just getting the timing right. And, you know, there's no better way to get everybody focused on that than burn your bridge behind you and move into the future. So, scary.
Speaking of the future, we've talked a bit about non-iPhone controller.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep.
When is it going to be VR? When am I going to walk into my house and say, hey, put on the new Zoo record, dot, 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 dot. What are you guys doing about it?
Well, obviously, we were big believers in the iPhone and the iPad. And if you're a lean forward listener, those aren't going to go away, because if you love putting together your queue, we were just talking about that. That's a way superior way to do that. Now, Amazon with the Echo found a really interesting thing for lean back listening, which is, you know, play BBC One and it plays. You don't have to fish your phone out of your pocket. You don't have to. And I don't care what age you are. It's easy to say, what's the temperature outside? There's no real technology involved in you asking for that. Now, if you want to reorder a playlist or, you know, even the music services are going to have to change, because if they're making playlists that are dynamic, you don't know what to ask for. So I think it's just the beginning of how what we call across the room or far field voice RICO works. But I'm a believer in that. You know, I think that train's left the station, and now it's going to be interesting to see how it incorporated in. I mean, I'll give you a perfect example. One of the fun features of Sonos is waking up to music, set an alarm. Then you're confronted with, how do I do snooze? You know, do I pull the iPhone next to my bed? Do I, you know, what do I do? Well, there's, you know, if you're next to somebody and you just woke them up with your alarm, there's nothing better than snooze, right? Right out of your mouth. And I think you're going to see all sorts of things of that nature come across. It's early. You know, Echo, for example, is only US and it's a global market, but I think you'll see it all over the place.
So VR, not virtual reality.
Yeah, I don't know how to use VR, virtual reality, with music around your home yet, but you put that headset on and
be
stumble around.
A lot of cords.
Yeah.
But voice recognition is one of the next.
Yeah, I think so. It's early, but I think it's got legs.
Excellent.
Especially for lean back. So I have one more question for you. I heard you had dinner with David Bowie once, and I heard it was an interesting dinner. So can you tell me about it?
Yeah, we had a 40th birthday dinner for the lead singer of the Pixies, Black Francis, and his name's Charles Thompson. And he was good friends with David Bowie. Bowie covered Cactus, a Pixies song, was a huge Pixies fan. And he wanted to meet David Byrne, because he's a massive Talking Heads fan.
So you brought David?
And I brought David Byrne and Charles, and he brought David Bowie. And I don't know how I got there.
That was the quid pro quo.
But I got to sit next to Bowie.
Wow. Which
was pretty outstanding, considering today's another momentous,
yeah,
maybe two of the greatest artists in our lifetimes ever, right? In the past and last short period of time. But the thing about Bowie was, and he was probably my favorite. I had an image of him and a vision that was very austere and, you know, almost scary, because he was such an artist. Same thing with Prince, by the way, ironically. But he sat next to me and he chatted me up for an hour and a half, and he was positively chatty. The good news was, and this was whenever, probably 04 or 05, 06, all he talked about was new bands. So he talked about, at the time, the new records that were out at the time. These were debut albums by MIA, TV on the Radio, and Secret Machines. And he couldn't stop talking about them. And it was, I left there, forget that I was pinching myself and thinking, oh my fucking God, I just got to eat with David Bowie. And David Byrne and Charles Thompson are friends and clients, so it was a little bit different, you know, and even though some people, what have you, but and they don't talk about current bands. They're not into it. So for Bowie to talk about all of those artists that we either have worked with or loved or discovering the same records, it's pretty uplifting, you know, sort of what I was saying to you about lean forward.
Music discovery, yeah.
Music discovery. Yeah, there's some good Prince stories too, but, you know, hopefully people will remember them over the next few weeks. So John, let me ask you a question about the labels. I know you're not in a position where you have to necessarily go fight with them. And you've befriended Lucien, and they're probably using you as a bit of a data reporter, sort of gentle coach, you know, et cetera. How are you finding their attitudes? That to me obviously went from an almost police state around digital music. Where are we now in today's world?
Yeah, I
mean, attitudinally.
You know, Lucien started out of the UK, so he was involved with Spotify in the early days. Him and Rob Wells, you know well. So when he came here and took over all of Universal, I think he probably had the most open mind, short of a lot of the independents, Daniel Glass and some of the others. And it's been interesting watching him re-architect Universal Music, and of course they're the biggest. So if you're right, we don't participate in the revenue flow in any way, and it's an open platform. So we're in the unique position where we're friends with the artists, friends with the managers, friends with the labels, friends with the service, and friends with the customer. And that's a rare place to be in music, as you know, not arguing over how you slice a penny. It took some time to build some credibility with him because he viewed us as a tech company. And anytime a tech company would come in and visit him, it would be a guarded
steal your copyright. Sure, of course.
And I think over time, he helped me a bunch, and hopefully I opened his eyes a little bit to the tech. You know, I would bring data in, and I mean, just funny stuff, like Pandora would report their revenue through Sound Exchange, and Sound Exchange would report it to Universal and put it in other, so they couldn't see it. And, you know, I would bring up, here's Pandora, it's not as bad for you as you think, and it doesn't hurt you know, your on-demand service. Or when he was about to launch, when Apple Music was about to launch and he wanted to understand what's this gonna do to our download business, I could show him what happened in Sweden. And so hopefully it's helpful. And I think he's built a vision for leaning in. They still haven't made a, you know, I think they posted their first up revenue.
Everybody
period.
Did.
Yeah. Yeah. Which is since what, 98 or something. So turn the corner, or just about turn the corner, because the physical's still dropping. So I could imagine a little instability until it's really strongly there. And it's, you know, it's in a pretty impressive change he's led through. It's hard to take a industry from, you know, I don't know, $14 billion to,
well,
you know.
Let me say it this way, from wealth and power into a big fucking ditch.
Yeah.
And barely out of the ditch, and now into the smaller ditch.
Yeah.
And crawling your way out, right?
Yeah, and you can see him re-architecting that team. So I think they really need to find a way to make a entrepreneurial friendly and venture capital friendly ecosystem yet, but they're getting the on demand working.
And what about Sony and Warner? Warner has an owner that's invested in Spotify. He was in Beats.
Yeah, Stephen Cooper.
I think Len Blavatnik.
Oh, Len.
Access.
Yeah,
and I think Tidal, I think he may have put money into, or one of the others. And Sony was obviously a tech company, still is supposedly a tech company, although I think the films and music are driving a lot of their profitability, and they may have had the worst record of tech implementation out of all the tech companies that relate to digital music. What do they like to deal with? Them and Warner right now? I'm just curious, because too much focus on Universal.
You know, my experience with Warner is Stephen Cooper's not really accepted on the inside of the music industry. You would know better than me, but he's the most flexible about trying different business models, but it's also the smallest label of the majors, and I don't think he's going to unduly influence Lucien or Doug. And of course, Doug and Lucien...
don't say the word.
Probably aren't the best buddies, but... you know, I think they're all leaning into streaming music, so it's common between them. You know, you watch SoundCloud work on Universal, then, you know, Warner was easy and Sony was next. So I think that's starting to work, if that makes sense. There aren't huge differences between them.
So my guess is that this audience has been, or I'm assuming, besides Spotify, YouTube, et cetera, has been a heavy Groove Shark, Beatport, SoundCloud audience. Okay. And we can talk Groove Shark stories and Beatport
stories. Well, they're gone now.
I know, all day long. But what do you see in terms, you've added SoundCloud to Sonos, I don't know, what, a year or two ago?
Yeah, last year.
And there's still issues to me with it on the implementation of
Sonos. Yeah,
actually, all across, including on the app, in Sonos, figuring out what you want to find. It's a trick.
Well, SoundCloud is finding their business, and they're buffeted a bit by, you know, the labels are in a mode where they have one hammer, which is paid on demand, and they're hitting everything with that right now. And I think it needs to be a little more nuanced than that, because SoundCloud, as you know,
has not the same as Spotify.
Not the same, you know. And if they try and catch Spotify and Apple and Google, it's, you know, it'll be a little tougher. Maybe they can do it with other advantages, but I think SoundCloud's tried to pilot their way through that, and you know, hopefully the, and I think the industry is getting better. Hopefully it's much faster for the next, you know, Turntable FM reinvented or any one of the services that I think are, you know, I don't know if you remember, Peter Kafka wrote a story in 2007 called The Dead Zone, and he put every, you know, you would have smiled at this because this guy is the most brilliant, forward-looking music entrepreneur. He started the first digital music company, I think, in 1995, way early. So you were on the list, your Artist Direct, right? But it was the logos of all these wonderful music companies, all of them killed. And the article is The Dead Zone. And that was 2007.
Great. I'm in the middle of The Dead Zone. Yeah. It's fantastic.
Well, it wasn't a friendly...
I'm kidding.
It wasn't friendly to
very aware
new companies.
Of
yeah.
How early we all were. But I think that's actually part of the point, right? I do, occasionally do IMSs, and I enjoy speaking about the industry and mostly where it's going. And it still feels like we're in a mid-phase, to your point, or in a mid-place, not in the final, you know, the final teams are not out on the field.
Oh, well, I mean, you just gave an example of how the artists aren't using all their tools. So it isn't even really, this is the internet in 1995.
Yeah, it's just out
maybe
of the
that's
locker
your point.
Room. Right.
Yeah.
I was going to say that. I still feel like we'd be searching on Excite, Alta Vista,
yeah,
InfoSeek,
exactly.
Ask Jeeves, and we'd be texting with ICQ, Apple Instant Messenger, or AOL Instant Messenger, sorry. And they wouldn't talk to each other,
yeah,
right? Which is called interoperability. And you just told me that there's no interoperability between streaming music services. I come to your house, I better have subscriptions for so-and-so. So it feels like the same development arc.
Yeah.
Other than paid streaming, hopefully.
Yeah, I mean, why can't I tweet a song that you can play, you know, I guess I could find it on YouTube and tweet that, and you could, but there, you know, I should be able to tweet a song that with no trouble, whatever service you have, you can play, right?
Yep.
So that's still rudimentary, right?
So we're still early.
We're early.
Fuck, I started 20 years ago.
I know.
God damn.
It's rare. I usually around Sonos, people say, well, I'll interpret John MacFarlane for you because they view me as forward-looking. I interpret you for everyone else because you're way out of me.
Speaking of being way out, you and I have had some discussions, and this is way out, so of bundled subscriptions. Okay?
Yeah.
And I bring
I
it up.
I figured we'd go there.
Well, I gotta go there a little bit. And I think the reason I want to go there isn't because of the massive success of Google Play, which announced as a music service, but if you drove on Sunset Boulevard and saw the Bowie and Beck billboards, it would say music, video, movies, films, or movies, television, books, and video games, and more, all right? And I'm not sure anybody really understood it, and I'm still trying to figure out how Amazon's going to pay for a music service when they include shipping, right, in Prime. So, and the reason I'm so... that I care about this is I watched, and as you know, gave many talks about the cable industry and the telcos and the wireless telcos and what they all did. And a guy that one of my best friends worked for was the CEO of AT&T, and he got fired by his board for buying a cable company and saying, hey, in a few years, we're going to bring you your data plan,
an old service,
cell phone, your home phone, your cable or satellite TV. And they fired him and said he was wrong.
Too early.
And I'm not sure anybody thinks that was wrong, right? That was right. So I'm watching Prime on the field today, right? You get a million songs, they're going to launch a new music service. I don't know if Amazon's music service will be inside or a separate product, all right? We don't know yet. But if it's inside Prime, I freak out about how the money gets carved up, right? You pay $99, $129 a year, whatever the number is. And I think most people think it's for shipping. Google Play comes out, all the others are going to come. Apple TV, first of all, I still say Netflix is going to buy Spotify. I'm making a call right here, all right? And then I have a bundled
service. Are you told to read that?
He knows, right? It's been written about. I'll make the call. We're going into an era of what I think will be interesting mergers and acquisition, M&A. And I think people will buy the same way Mike Armstrong, who was the CEO of AT&T, bought a cable company, ended up getting bought by Singular after he got fired, so a wireless company. But everybody, whether it's Fios, UVerse, you know, God knows how many ads we all get from AT&T, Verizon, T-Mobile, Sprint, God knows what it is. I don't believe that Apple TV and Apple Music stays that separate. And I don't believe Netflix doesn't buy Spotify. So the reason I'm jamming the conversations are two reasons. One is to say, hey, how are you going to carve up that money? Okay, now I'm not paying $10 a month. That's clean. That's music. If I'm paying $69 a month, $49, it doesn't matter what it is. For all my entertainment, every kind, I play video games all day. If I'm a gamer and I'm playing video games all day, am I really still paying $10 to movies and music? Or, you know, I'm not sure how that's going to go. Is it usage-based?
Well, that's the role, of the service, because they're charging a monthly fee, but they're paying out a price per track. So they've got to find where their profitability point is between the, you know, when Rhapsody first got started, it was a penny a play. And so when Sonos got up and running on Rhapsody, they actually had to raise their price because people were using it so much, they had to increase the subscription price. So those two aren't at odds. Now, how that all flows through to the artist, of course, that's important, and that's your job.
And Is Pandora? I'll figure it out. Is Pandora a bundled service when they launch on demand with RDO? I mean, in some ways, right? It's a radio service that you can pay for to have no ads.
Well, they have 80 million active users in the U.S., so they are by far.
And just fired their CEO.
Well, Tim Westergren's their CEO now. Yeah, they fired Brian. Yeah. But if you've got 80 million engaged people using that service so to sell them a subscription service isn't impossible. I don't know who I would advantage. Apple, who has your credit card, that is, they get you to say yes. That's their path. Spotify, who you're engaging a bunch with that app.
It's not just your credit card. Let's get real. They got everything.
Sure. Yeah. Or Spotify, who's the pure play, adding video. You know, if you want to talk about Netflix, I think Spotify's adding more and more video. So they're coming that way too. So I don't know.
By the way, look, Facebook has not declared.
Yeah.
And Snapchat has not declared.
Yeah. Yeah, that's
so
right.
It's gonna be
There's more players here,
so
for sure.
For me, the next couple of years in this world, and I know there's been a lot of talk about the electronic business, I'm sure over this conference, and where it's at in its evolution and where it's going to. But to me, this where it's at and evolution, part of what chapter in the digital music story we're telling, every year it's different. Right? And every year there's different players that have come on the field and are attempting and spending and marketing and trying to get consumers. And weirdly, I teach a few classes, and when I do it, the first thing I do is I go around the room, can't do it here, and ask, how do you get your music? How are you listening? And I want specifics.
And what are the age
changes
groups of
every
these
year.
People?
It's always college, so I see the same constant.
So you see mostly Spotify, I would assume.
Changes every year. The weird thing is you start to see when music services drop off because no one in the room mentioned.
Because they're the vanguard.
You can see the trend. This year was the first year I had five people bring up QQ Music and Chinese music services, paying, right?
Well, that's a tough one, because the QQ has this thing called an Emerald Club, and it's not just music. So you can get QQ Music for free.
So it's a bundled service. Kidding. I'm just teasing.
A bundled service if you want to pay, and you can have it for free if you don't. I'm not sure that's what you mean.
I'm teasing. But yeah, it's different every year, and I think that's part of the challenge, is to figure out where to spend your time.
Yeah, but why do you're representing a band, and Amazon does a bundled service, as long as the label is that your band is working with is getting a per track royalty you're happy with? How do you care how they package it to the
listener? I care because I'm a fan and a freak of technology and its growth and its impact on our business.
You think that'll accelerate to the billion users?
I think it'll all add up to the billion users. I also think the artist issue is, where do you spend your time? I do not believe, although I'm a believer, and I'm sorry, this is tech speak, and a write once, publish multiple, meaning, create one set of content, push it out to all the channels.
Yeah,
I think that's not how the world really works. And I think marketing and promotion is changing as much as consumption.
For right? sure.
And so when you're in the artist business in one way or another, whether you're at my job or whether you're running a label or working a label, or you're independent, you're a publicist, you have to figure out where to spend your time, right? And you're trying to figure out, if you're a publicist, what interview to give where, because you only have X time. And that's usually a ranking of audience and importance. So I think the understanding of what demographic might like the artist and where do I spend time, if it's a young artist and the appeal is to kids and it's a pop artist, or it's Kygo, maybe I spend more time on Snapchat than I do on Facebook. It's an older demographic, right? And I conduct, Steve Aoki, maybe Instagram's the right
But
platform.
Your point is that's going to be much better because you have the data now. I mean, I remember the classic one was when Adele did 21. They didn't know what size venues to do. And, now you can look at who's listening on Pandora, Apple Music, and figure out not only what size venues, but which ones, right?
Yeah. I mean, you tend to know from other data sources, and I would actually say the data, it's such a jumbled mess at the moment.
Yeah, getting it isn't enough, well organized yet. Yeah,
getting an organized data set of statistics that
is hard.
Makes sense, we're not there yet. Everybody's in a data rush and competition to say, hey, I got geo, my data is worth X, and I'm going to monetize it one day.
It's almost too much data right
it's
now.
It's too much data, you right parse data. It. And a lot of it's meaningless. It's just, here's another statistic we can throw out. And each industry is going to have a different view of which data has high utility to them. So we shall see. Bottom line is, we're in the middle of evolution.
At the beginning, actually. Yeah.
Pete, you're standing with a microphone.
I was just going to say, I think with time's opened up to the floor for some questions.
Questions?
I have a question. You know what? You're talking about streaming and all this emerging. And what I feel like I'm not an expert on internet, but about curating, where do you go in terms of playlists and everything? I think there's a big gap there that should be, explored in terms of bringing quality to the, to whatever we listen to.
We would both agree with you.
I think it's just starting, Carolina, because obviously
you should do a playlist.
We talk Pete about it all the time, but I think the Zane Lowe move to Apple was the first big one.
Yeah.
And you're going from almost a programmer, and I'm not talking radio programmer, I'm talking geek code programmer, thought about algorithmic playlists into a human side. And I think what Amazon did was they started with that, and then they started to introduce, hey, your favorite so-and-so's favorite list was this, and they threw five or six different ways to navigate, and consumers chose. I think this was the year, couple of the Spotify new release playlist, as well as
For You for Apple. Are you a fan of that? Because that's
too much for me. I'm the wrong person to ask, because I am a programmer, so I don't like being programmed too. But that, I'm the wrong person to ask.
Yeah.
But I do think that Spotify, the fact that people are arguing and record labels are now pouncing to try to influence placement on their playlist, and that they're showing results, listening results,
again.
And we can see it. You can see an artist starting to break. You can see an artist having interest from promoters. You can see an artist getting more press and blog attention because of a placement on a playlist. This is new. It's going to happen, right? Just like if playlists and new radio. My own opinion, Carolina, is there's going to be a lot of development, both in algorithmic, might be Pandora-esque, and human, and a blend.
Yeah.
And we're just early, and there's going to be a lot of it. And I'm sure Pete will be a part of it as well.
And we talked earlier today about the power of Spotify playlists now and how people are actually plugging to be on them effectively, like they would plug radio stations.
Yeah.
But it just started, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Another question? Man with the mic.
Hi, my name is Taka from Japan. So when it comes to the windowing, some people in the industry talked about windowing, but the window real estate, it draws so much piracy from Kanye's new album. So do you have any idea other option should be windowed?
Well, the front end money comes through windowing, but the back end money is from the per play, right?
I think the answer is, just like everything else, we're in an early developmental time. You had Taylor Swift leave her record off of Spotify because of the freemium policy that probably doesn't last that much longer. Then Adele, you'd have Kanye on Tidal and a few exclusives. The best way I can say this is, historically, in 94, 95, 96, 97, when the browser first hit and we were all freaking out that the internet was here, AOL went and made deals with Time Magazine for exclusive content.
Put the CDs in.
You remember?
Yeah, you're right.
And the other way, that Time Magazine's content would only be on the AOL service. It went through a period of exclusives, and it didn't work. And I think we're in that period of exclusives right now. All right. So when records are on this service or that service only or what have you, I think the artists are bummed that their music's not heard as much on all platforms. And obviously over in the physical world, you know, if Target or Walmart or somebody got an exclusive, people were freaking in that day. So this is a long answer to your question. My own belief for a long time is that there will be a new release tier of payment once there's more subscribers. It won't be expensive, but let's say it's $1.99 to $3.99.
Oh, you think it'll be an incremental tier?
Yeah, I think it'll be incremental tier for a tier new artist, major artist, okay? When Klangstuff released a new album, they're not going to be in there because they're going to need all the basic users to listen. But when Kanye's new record's going to come in, the window will be a paid window. Today, there is no paid window. There's nobody doing it. And you have a freemium over here and a non-free over here, and you have so-and-so over there, and you got Tidal. I think over time, we will find new release windows. I don't believe, when I tell even the most ardent music person that fuck these windows and da-da-da-da, I said, so Star Wars should have been free to use it? And they go, no. I go, why would Adele or Taylor do that? You wouldn't. So I think it's a couple years away, but windowing, it will be a real whether it's superstar. I think labels will have an election. Do I take the extra bit of money I get for that period of time, 30 days, 15 days, whatever it is, and what's the timing? I think that'll be the sustainable long-term answer. But right now we're in a trial and error of windowing era.
You know, the other dimension to that is like what Kanye just did with The Life of Pablo. Do you get to participate in the creative process? Because it's been
traditional. That happened after everybody couldn't listen to it.
True.
That was the trick, right?
True.
That was his save. But yes.
You're yeah.
Right. Another question, Rishi.
Yeah. Hey, Mark. Nice to see you, Rishi from Plus 8. Question with regards to blockchain. As a visionary and leader in the music technology world, just thoughts on what's it going to take for the industry to come together and embrace blockchain?
A lot of time.
Yeah, I hope you have a lot of time.
A lot of time. He keeps saying, I'm early, I'm this and that. Let me tell you, my mother said to me, hey, son, next time don't wait at the fucking bus stop for 15 years. And it made me realize there's no, being early isn't good, it's timing, right? It's fun to speculate. So blockchain, the first thing is, I think a lot of people in the room don't know what it is.
Yeah, I was just going to say you should explain it.
And I think me attempting to explain it would be funny. But imagine there's a payment processing system which is democratic and fast, and that every purchase ever made gets immediately authorized by a server close to you and has a log entry. Okay, just leave it there. The rest of it's too complex, all right? But it ties in with digital currency and the ability to have money transferred freely throughout the world. And basically, whether it's royalty payment systems or anything else might be tied one day to the blockchain, which is basically an overhaul of the entire financial banking system that exists today, right? And the banks would use it too. My gut is that, like virtual reality, which I was with Jaron Lanier in 1994 starting, and here we are 2016. They still got 50 cords and medical problems, and everybody thinks Oculus is going to be a hit. And I'm like, you guys are nuts. There's not one gamer I know doing it for any extended wear. I think blockchain's 10, 15, 20 years away. It's going to be fascinating because it's going to have so much impact on the world, both on the back end, right? But I think the fight in finances is on the front end, right? To me right now, this PayPal being the giant out there, but most people don't know how to use it for all of its tool set, Apple Pay, Android Pay, and everybody else, what they call FinTech, which you were obviously into, Rishi. I know it'll work more efficiently with the blockchain. I think the front end's going to happen 10 years before the back end. So that's my thought. I think it's a lot of work to fix the back end. I think consumers can sign up for the front end. It still hits the same back end system. So I'm reading about it sort of in the same way I'm reading about life on Mars, that kind of time period.
Well, you're driving your car with your eyes closed, right?
Driving my car. That's here. I get that one. Almost here.
Question down here, Dom.
Hi, my name is Katie. I'm a DJ and producer, and this is more of a suggestion with Sonos. I noticed that when I'm loading my SoundCloud, like I'm someone somewhere else,
yeah,
and I'm loading my SoundCloud, it doesn't show the mixes from like a guest mix that maybe I did on somebody else's SoundCloud, and I kind of loaded it into mine. It doesn't show up. It only shows what I've uploaded, so that might be a good suggestion, like DJs mixes, all that kind
agree.
Of stuff.
There are a whole bunch of private Dropboxes, all sorts of things in SoundCloud we need to get supporting.
And then another suggestion I was going to say is that
I agree with you, and it's why I brought it up, because SoundCloud drives me nuts, because I get a lot of private SoundCloud links.
Yeah.
And you get on Sonos, which is a great interface at home, and you can't use them.
Yeah.
It drives me crazy. So.
And another suggestion I was just going to say is that I live in Ibiza the quarter of a year, every year, and I met this company called CrowdMix.
Oh, yeah. Cool.
Yeah. They're going to solve a lot of those problems, which Rob Wells, who you're talking about earlier, used to be the head of digital at Universal. He's the CEO. But I met him, and I think it's an amazing product, and I think it's going to help a lot. So you guys should check it out.
Well, we know it well. So it's less about checking out. What I think it's about is we talked about the future of user interface, UX, and CrowdMix, for those that don't know, is a social-driven interface for a music service. It's not new releases, playlists, browse, singles, albums, artists. It's your social feed. So imagine your Instagram and your Facebook feed is your Spotify interface or whatever, right? That's the basics of CrowdMix. And then when you like an artist, it puts you into different groups. It's really cool, and the interface is really cool. Here's my thing. Here's my thing about it.
I
think Rob's great, and I think if they can get to market fast, because they don't have a music service and they don't have users, right? I'm looking at you. They don't have a music service and they don't have users yet, right? You saw it. You saw the beta. Yeah, which means they don't have a... Okay. So, and they don't have the music service. So they have to sit on top of all the music services to win. They have to be an interface that's used. My supposition, and I want them to win, is that everybody... You know, you saw Apple have a failed launch with Connect and being a socially driven interface, so to speak, all right? I think you're going to see all of the competitors, all the digital music services, launch another interface so that you don't just drive it through search and all the things I suggested or playlist, but you can drive it through social. And so when I said Facebook and Snapchat haven't gotten into the game, what would Facebook's interface probably be like? Be all your friends from Coachella this week suggesting what they were listening to and what was the best, which is going to be a competitor to CrowdMix. So I think CrowdMix is the first cool new company to do it. I am worried that everyone else is going to jump in and try to merge social and a music service quickly and box them out. But if they get there fast enough, it's going to be a win. So that's my two cents.
Well, it's just going to get bought.
Yeah. Or Pete and I have discussed it. If he's smart, he gets moving fast. They sell it to one of these people and say, I have a good solution for your social-driven interface. That's what I actually think the outcome is.
The other thing to realize is this audience is huge music fans. But, you know, if you want to talk about the billion that you'd like to go after, they're going to get introduced to QQ Music, or they're going to get introduced to Spotify or Apple Music through their native interface, and then you're asking them to learn another interface. And if you're, you know, if you're the overlap of Super Social plus that music service, maybe they'll learn that too. That's a lot of, you know, that's a lot for a person to take on. And it's a learning curve. And every time you have a learning curve like that, hey, I just learned Spotify, I know how to do it. Now I have to learn that other thing. Plus Snapchat, plus it's just friction. So I wouldn't underestimate that.
And I do think that Facebook and Snapchat will be their competition when it happens.
Yeah.
And then others will switch.
I agree.
But he's right. You don't want to go back and forth to Netflix interfaces, to Apple TV interfaces.
Don't forget the guy running engineering at Snapchat now was one of the CTO of Pandora. So that you're going to see a lot of intermixing.
Yeah.
Another question in the front? Oh, Mike is heading your way.
Hi, my name is Andrea, and I run a network for women who work in the music industry called She Said So. I don't know if this question has been raised yet today, but I'm going to raise it now.
Cool.
Have things improved over the past few years? You've obviously been in the industry for way longer than me, and I'm talking strictly about executive level. Have things improved?
For women.
For women. For music executives, women music executives. And if they have improved, what are, you know, the factors that contributed to it? And what can we do to
She's
make
gonna
things better?
She's going to hate my answer. I'd say go. No, but...
I'd say yes, but you go first.
I don't know. I just judge by the number I see, and it isn't drastically larger.
No, I think the record company level, though, I think our company, we are so hyper-conscious, and not just women. It's all equality. It's gender pay. It's the whole bit, right? I think there's this whole country is going through a rotten primary election thing, okay, which could take all the progress back 10 years forward to whatever. I think there's a heightened consciousness. There's really strict HR policies and laws that are driving, especially in big companies. I think there's a lot of media about all of it, which really helps. I can tell you internally, and again, I think about the CEO of Universal Music Publishing, I think about Michelle Anthony, I think about the partners in our company, my partner Sarah Newkirk, who's 15 times better and smarter than I am. I think that it feels better. I don't know what the numbers say. I would tell you the consciousness is higher, but I think it's also down to who the executives are. And, you know, for me, the record business and a lot of the music business was an old boys network and very ego fueled in the old days.
Tech too. So it doesn't get any better when
tech
the two get together.
Obviously with, you know, the harassment cases and things, I think everything pushes a little bit farther. I hate when it goes forward, you know, two steps forward, one step back. It feels like the consciousness is better. It feels like there's less egomaniacal, big dick bullshit. But I can't tell. I still think the music industry is in growth. And I think there's been a lot of entrepreneurial opportunity. I think about the people we deal with all day, and it always needs to be better, but it doesn't feel, on a micro level, sure, but on a macro level, it doesn't feel like people are elbowing out anybody or limiting. But I'm also a hopeful optimist, so I'm not sure it's the right answer.
Yeah, you're asking two guys, so the safest thing to say would be no until it's really obvious, but that's an opinion.
Maybe I'm giving the wishful thinking answer.
Marc Geiger, John MacFarlane, thank you very much.